Hi, folks. My name is Alex, and welcome to another episode of Any Given Saturday. Today, I'm delighted to be joined by Shea Dixon, a college football recruiting expert. Shea worked for 247Sports for 10 years, covering recruiting and the LSU beat. In 2009, Shea graduated from LSU. Thank you very much for joining me today, Shea.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me. I'm excited.
No problem at all. So let's start then with your time as a student at LSU, if that's okay. What was the reason behind choosing LSU as the academic institution that you wanted to attend, and what did you study?
I applied to a handful of schools. I grew up in Memphis, Tennessee, and then went to Hattiesburg in high school. My dad took a job at Southern Miss as a geographer there. And I knew I didn't want to go to USM or really any of the Mississippi schools. So I applied to a bunch of out-of-state schools and kind of looked at Missouri and Vanderbilt and some other places for journalism, but ultimately picked LSU. I got in. They gave me more of a scholarship than anyone else. And then both my parents went to LSU. So I'd grown up in an environment, even though not in Louisiana, where kind of LSU was front and center when it came to college sports. And
sure,
we would go to games and see them play baseball and in the 90s and all those things. So I had a knowledge already of what LSU was about. And I think I looked too at, you know, kind of wanting to go somewhere where I thought I could have fun and party just as much as I could go to school. So I think LSU was the right fit. And I came to Baton Rouge in 2004 for college and just never left. Not still in college though. So
yes,
I graduated.
and did you play any sports during your time in college?
No, I didn't play football, which I primarily cover football, American football, obviously. But I didn't play any football growing up, and in college, I really just focused on writing and obviously going to school and hanging out with friends and all that. But I worked for the student paper, and then not long after that, got into the recruiting side of things. So I didn't have the background, I would say, a lot of people who cover sports or talk about sports. At least they had played football in high school or whatever it might be. And I guess in the coaching realm of it all, I'm like the Mike Leach, the one who never played any of it and is just involved now. So I've enjoyed it. It's certainly been a cool experience because I didn't have those experiences of playing football growing up. So being around kids in high school now and a college team like LSU, that's obviously, you know, one of the best and most talented in the country, and seeing all the guys come through here and go on to professional careers is it makes the job worthwhile. It's a cool experience. I don't think I would have ever gotten, obviously, had I not taken up writing and gotten into football.
Yeah. And whilst you were a student, was recruiting something that you followed? You know, did you kind of always kind of want to move into that?
No. And I always tell that to people when I go speak to students at LSU or wherever it might be, is so many people, whether it's you're talking about journalism and whatever medium it is, or just everybody's normal jobs, and I don't think many people have it picked out. Nor should you have to, you know, at 18, 19 years old, know what you're going to do or going through high school. So I always knew in high school, I had written for the local paper in Hattiesburg, and I had done some stuff for Sports Illustrated for Kids back in the day, but none of it, was ever recruiting related. And long story short, I had gotten on scholarship as a mass communications major at LSU. And, you know, one of the prerequisites in the fine print was that I had to work for the Reveille in the student newspaper here. So I was working for the Daily Reveille, the Reveille at the time. And after about 6 months, a year, maybe my first year, you know, I didn't understand yet or have any appreciation for a chain of command. So I thought as a freshman, I would come in and just start covering the football team. But I was covering swimming and diving and whatever, you know, there's a lot of sports on campus, 20 something sports. So cross country, things like that, golf, tennis. And I said, okay, well, you know, I thought highly of myself at the time. I was young, dumb, and stupid, and said I should be doing something you know, I want to be covering football or baseball. And when they sort of said, okay, you got to, you know, cover this, these other kind of non-ticketed sports for a couple of years, I said, well, I'd rather just go to school and hang out with my friends. So I did that and was informed that if I don't work at the Reveille, they were pulling my scholarship, which wasn't an option. So I had told that to my roommate at the time, and my roommate was a diehard recruiting fan. This was back in the early 2000s. It was really just Rivals.com was sort of kind of out there, and Scout.com at the time, but Rivals was the big recruiting website, and he had a membership there, and he was paying whatever, 10 bucks a month to read about all the recruiting stuff. And he said, you should just call all these kids and put it in the school paper, and then we can just read it for free and we'll be able to ask you about it. And that's how I pitched that to the Reveille. Hey, let's start a recruiting section, which they still have now. So David Hellman, who works for the Dallas Cowboys now, he and I started up a recruiting section and wrote about LSU football recruits. And from there, I parlayed that into a job working at Scout and ultimately 24/7. Been doing it about, what, God, almost 20 years, which makes it seem like a very long time. But I didn't even know what recruiting was when I went to college. You could have told me there was 500 five-stars in every class and I would have believed you. I didn't have any sort of insight knowledge, let alone know how much people truly cared about it.
Sure. And but I imagine, you know, being able to cover the non-ticketed sports, did that must have given you an appreciation for those. And were there any sports in particular that you now enjoy watching a lot and covering because of your time early on as a student?
Yeah, you know, I wish I would have had more appreciation for it then, because I think now I'm as fascinated by a lot of the non-ticketed sports at LSU as I am with, you know, football or baseball or, you know, basketball, whatever it might be. Just because you see the time everyone puts in. I remember writing an article about a friend of mine. He was a buddy, but he played for the tennis team and he was pre-med and was also playing, you know, SEC men's tennis at the time. And he had given a quote in there that said, you know, my friends will call me throughout the day, normal college friends. Hey, let's go get lunch. What are you doing? And he says, I'm doing the same thing I'm doing every day. I'm in, you know, workouts from 6 to 8 a.m. and then I'm in class and then I'm pre-med, you know, meetup tutoring or whatever it might be. And then we have practice and then we have team meetings. And it, as I learned more about all these sports, and I guess some people who have played sports their whole lives or at the, you know, collegiate level or certainly professionally would know the time and how much goes into it and having to balance in college, you know, an actual life with, you know, academics and then playing a sport. It's wild. The football team isn't the only one out there that's going 12 months a year. I mean, every sport is. And I think that's one thing that stuck kind of with me over time is college student athletes are really impressive. Like if I'm hiring people out there in the job market, I'll find all the college student athletes you've got because they've got a real good grip on time management and how to balance everything and the work that has to be put into being, you know, turning out a really great product. So I've had a real appreciation for that. And I think now, you know, I wish, and then I didn't, like I said, I didn't appreciate it much then, but now I would be excited to go cover swimming and diving. They've got Brooks Curry, who, you know, was a gold medalist with Team USA and now broke the SEC indoor record in one of his meets at Tennessee this past spring. And Mondo Duplantis came through in track and field. And obviously now is world's best pole vaulter, really. And a number of sprinters have come through the track program as they were number one. And you can kind of just bounce around. The women's golf teams have the number one player in the world. So LSU has, I think, just has so much. And I think LSU, the university, does a good job talking about it and obviously promoting all their student athletes. But I don't think the common fan probably realizes just how much talent is on LSU's campus at all times that kind of aren't just from the big few sports.
Sure. And what did you do after you graduated from LSU?
So I was working full-time at scout.com, right, doing recruiting coverage when I was still at LSU. So once I graduated, I just sort of moved straight into more, you know, kind of fully focused on full-time work with Scout. And that would have been soon after their 2007 national championships, like 08, 09, I was full-time, no longer in school. And I stayed there all the way up until, I guess, 2012. I moved over to 247Sports, and that was a great experience for me. I mean, I can have no regrets. Met so many great people, met so many great kids, you know, around Louisiana and the country that came to LSU, and many that didn't. But just getting to see everybody's story and getting to kind of watch them rise, as I've talked about before, kind of having a front row seat to a lot of these kids, the Tyron Matthews of the world or whomever it might be, that, you know, you've known them since they were in 10th grade and had just started playing football, and to kind of get to watch their, you know, career and lives play out is obviously pretty cool. And I think LSU fans are amazing. And that's one thing that's kept me in this job, is how much people enjoy talking about the Tigers, or, you know, going to games, or excuse me, whatever it might be. That's been, I think, one reason why my career path has sort of just kind of been on the same straight line of focusing on covering LSU as an athletic program, and focusing on covering LSU recruiting, notably, you know, 95% football. But that's sort of the big ticket item. And I think just the combination of Louisiana, the fans, the talented teams, and people I've met here, is I've had no real itch to go anywhere else.
Yeah. And does it ever surprise you sort of how invested and passionate college sports fans are about recruiting? I mean, from what I've seen, there's even some fans that actually seem to care more about the recruitment process than the results in the field at times.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you stole the words out of my mouth. I can remember, in fact, my buddy that I referenced that I lived with in my freshman year, after my freshman year, that put me on to recruiting, I then found out that sort of opened a door of conversation for me with a lot of my other friends who I found out were big into recruiting. And there came points, I can remember, in college and after college, where they would spend the whole week on the message boards and reading articles and asking me about guys and who was coming in on visits. And then they would watch like half the game, or like wouldn't even be all that interested. It would maybe a cupcake game or whatever. And it would blow my mind. I said, God, y'all care more about who's coming in than even the product on the field. And they would say, hey, look, the coaches get paid a lot of money to figure out the product on the field. And it kind of is what it is for about, you know, 3 hours every Saturday. The recruiting is one that's fluid. It could go in any direction. You get to follow it 12 months a year. And obviously it is the lifeblood of the program. You know, there's no minor leagues, there's no developmental teams, you know, club teams or anything like that. It's go out there and recruit the best high school kids you can get. And yes, it, and there absolutely is a section of the fan base, bigger than most would expect, that care more about what they do in recruiting than what the actual product looks like on Saturday, which still blows my mind, but I guess it pays my bills, so I'll be fine with it.
And how has college football recruiting changed since you started covering it?
Oh God, how hasn't it? I mean, in the early 2000s, nobody had, there was no Twitter, there was no Instagram, you know, nobody, Facebook, I guess, was kind of taken off, but there wasn't a platform. Like if, you know, Alex visits LSU this weekend, nobody knows how the visit went unless someone was calling and doing an interview with Alex, or catching up with his high school coach or his parents or whatever it might be, or talking to sources around LSU or wherever it might be about how things went, and then passing that along. It was sort of the kind of go-to spot if you cared about recruiting, was having to go to a message board or figure out, you know, somewhere online where you could read about what happened. And now I think it's still that, but I think it's shifted over time of, look, kids can go on Instagram right now or Twitter or whatever it might be and drop an edit with their top teams or make a commitment or share some photos of how their weekend went or do a live chat or whatever it might be about it. But I think fans have kind of worked through that enough to where it's, you know, now I'm going to pay my money not to have to go dive through all that. Like, I'd rather somebody just tell me, interview them in a standard format, talk about it, give me the scoop. I don't want to have to go looking for it on 25 kids, you know, social media pages, which are going to be clouded up with whatever 16 to 18 year olds are talking about these days. But yeah, I'd say social media has changed it the most, and but also on our end, you know, now it's become for us that we have to utilize social media, you know, putting out, you know, instead of just writing an article, then you're having to make sure it's going out through, you know, the right traffic avenues or distribution avenues, I should say. And none of that was around, you know, back then, newsletters and Twitter and Facebook and using that as ways to drive traffic and all of that stuff, even YouTube, you know, interviews and Zoom and, yeah, and all of that. It wasn't around. So I think, like anything, everybody's pivoted a bit to figure out how you consume the information now, but in a way it's all cyclical. And I think we're kind of back to where people just want to find a handful of people they can trust in a certain, you know, pocket of the LSU football universe. And with recruiting, I think they just want to go find somewhere where they can read about it or hear people discuss it or talk about it without having to wade through, like I said, you know, all different social media accounts just to find out what you're looking for.
Sure. And following on from that, kind of, what do you think the future of college football recruiting will look like?
Well, I mean, with name, image, likeness, again, I think right now it's quite scary for everybody, in the sense of it's a complete unknown, like how I think, yeah, fans are looking at a bit of, are we just in free agency and now it's going to be a bidding war for kids? And, you know, like without any sort of real, you know, there's not like salary caps in place. So are the teams that Texas A&M and some of these teams that just have more money than a lot of other programs, are they just going to go, as Nick Saban said, buy the whole recruiting class? Is that kind of what's going to happen from here on out? And I think it'll cool a bit in the, yeah, coming years, whether that's through legislation, whether that's through, you know, a lot of these boosters saying, where's the return on my investment if I'm pouring this kind of money into prospects who then enter the transfer portal or don't play, or, yeah, or we didn't actually go to any sort of notable bowl game or compete for a championship or win a conference championship. You know, if you're not meeting these benchmarks that maybe the people who are giving the money presume you will, do they scale back on it? And I think between legislation, boosters, schools, coaches wisening up to saying, hey, look, I'm not just going to go out there and pay for every kid, because then it creates kind of unrealistic expectations in a locker room or for me or for my staff or whatever it might be. I think it kind of scales back a bit. I don't know when, but if we're talking the future, I would say in the next, we'll pull this later and I may be, you know, an old take that we can light on fire, but I don't think in 5 years NIL will have ruined college football or college sports like people think it is going to right now, or at least how people will kind of very quickly just say, oh, that sounds like a terrible idea and it's going to be the death of amateur athletics. I don't quite believe that to be the case.
Sure. And sort of, yeah, kind of following on from that as well, do you think NIL is making it harder or potentially easier for recruiting websites to actually predict where a prospect will end up?
I think right now it'll make it harder, certainly in the cases, yeah, of some guys when you get closer to signing day and let's say a kid's just being very open and saying, hey, NIL is going to play a factor. Well, anything can happen now in these, yeah, final 48, 72 hours, 24 hours, as schools say, hey, look, we're not in the lead and we need, you know, here's what we need to do to get there. And all of a sudden it shifts. So I think for me, a lot of my approach has been through the dawn of social media and with that kind of kids becoming a little bit more discreet maybe at times about where they're going. And now you toss in NIL stuff. I think that I've tried to just cover, let's say a recruit's lifespan of, you know, being a recruit is 3 years. Well, when he signs on the dotted line is one day, when he commits is one day, what's happening in all those other days. And I think I've tried to figure out the best way to cover that, because by the time a kid commits, maybe you do know where he's going, or you've got a very good feel, or maybe he's got a set announcement and everybody just sort of knows, okay, he's announcing on this day and this is probably where he's going, or if he's got a signing day decision that, you know, it's happening then. So I've just tried to cover the lead up and then obviously breaking commitments is fun and it's a rush and it's cool to be a part of, but it's a quite fleeting moment to where I think people quickly turn and say, okay, how did this happen? You know, what's the behind the scenes? Are they going to stick? Was NIL a factor? What does it mean for, you know, the rest of the recruiting class now? Who's up next? All those sorts of things are things I've tried to capitalize on more than just kind of where a kid's going or exactly when it might be happening or if it's a lock that he ends up somewhere and things like that.
Sure. And something that really fascinates me about recruiting, it's not just the players and the coaches, because that just like the players just come and go every year, but it's, you know, it's the job that you do. So sort of what is like the day-to-day life of a recruiting insider like, and sort of your schedule?
Yeah, well, right now, being in between jobs, my schedule's pretty open. I would say, though, normally I'd get up and, you know, clean out the emails, get set for the day. Our message boards, wherever we've been, have always been important. So kind of checking in early there and maintaining a presence throughout the day, because I think community is just so important. I think that's one thing that makes LSU and the fan base so great is South Louisiana is very community oriented. The LSU fan base is, you know, considered to be the same. And I think that the message boards are just sort of another way for LSU fans to kind of embrace that idea of a community, even if someone's in England or someone's in, you know, different pockets of the U.S. It's not all just kind of South Louisiana and Texas and Mississippi and Georgia. LSU fans are all over. And I think that, you know, the internet obviously has given them a way to kind of stay, you know, in together and in one place and able to discuss LSU. So I'd say I'd start out every day on message boards and spend a lot of time there, but I'd also often have and do a couple of things circled of what is a piece of news or two that people are wondering about that there's not an answer out there that nobody's reported on. And how do I go about finding that? And I'm pretty, also, I would consider that to be something I would do each day in addition to pretty detail oriented in terms of our site would always, we'd have set planners that, you know, at 8 a.m. and 10 a.m. and noon and 2 that these stories are going to be running and kind of, you know, it is a rundown of what's going to happen each week and then everything else sort of lanyard from there. So a lot of organizational, behind the scenes stuff, a lot of stuff spent scheduling or kind of monitoring our Facebook pages, our social media pages, our, you know, whatever, Twitter, you know, responding to people on emails or instant messages on the site or helping people out with troubles they might have on the site or whatever it might be. There's a lot, I guess, when we've always had kind of two-man, three-man, at times four-man teams of people running the site. So, you know, it's not some big corporation where everybody's handling everything and I can just sit around and write about, you know, whatever it might be. So a lot of it is just behind the scenes stuff that kind of makes everything go, that kind of goes unnoticed by obviously the general public and for good reason, if people aren't noticing it, then it's getting done. So I, a lot of, I'd say 50-50 between working and then interviews and meetings and behind the scenes random stuff dealing with the site would be most of the day. And then when you get into a season like football, every day there's something, whether it's you get to go to practice or you have a slate of interviews or you're meeting with the coach once or twice a week or his weekly radio show or the game on Saturday. So the falls are pretty hectic, I'd say, just because you've got football and that bleeds into basketball at the end. But the summer months, like right now where there's no sports going on at LSU is bliss. It's like the perfect time of year to actually have some time for everybody to breathe and reset before football season.
And who would you say has been the most interesting high school prospect that you've covered?
Oh man, Tyrann Mathieu would be up there. You know, I think Jordy Collada talked about it on y'all's interview of just his story from. Yeah. You know, and I think so often people think of Tyrann Mathieu's story of you know, he got kicked out of college. He was one of the best players in the country. He ends up slipping in the NFL draft and then goes and turns his life around and is now sort of kind of, you know, the gold standard for what an LSU, you know, excuse me, or LSU too, but an NFL football player is supposed to be, you know, doesn't, excels on the field as a team captain, you know, leads the way in the community with community service and makes himself very available and, you know, comes across as very likable and approachable, no matter who you might be a fan of. And they think of that sort of redemption story. But I think people so often forget, like, Tyron is like 5'10 or whatever. And in high school, he was 160 something pounds. And he was always considered too small. It was like, is he even big enough to play in the SEC? It used to be like the discussion. And when he went to LSU, he was the smallest guy on the field at all times. But I think about a year, year and a half, about when he was on fire playing, people started to forget about that and just referenced him as, oh, he's just the best player, not just on the field, but one of the most instinctual players you've ever seen play LSU football. So his story was a cool one. I think I was close early on, and he helped me a lot in kind of my beginning years, certainly giving me some, I guess I would call it, I don't know, if acknowledgement or from fans, what's the word I'm looking for, is where they trusted me and felt I was a legitimacy. You know, early on was Russell Shepard. He was a five-star. He was like number one quarterback, dual threat quarterback in the country. And he was very vocal about recruiting. So everybody always wanted to know what he had to say. And he would give me interviews. He would hook me up with info, whatever it might be, hook me up with other kids who could get for interviews. And again, this is before the social media days. So it was great to have, you know, someone like that, that was wise beyond his years and I could really work with even when he was in high school. And then he got to college and moved to receiver and bounced around. And obviously everybody wondered when he would play quarterback. And that was kind of the big discussion, and ends up going to the NFL and receiver there, played special teams, a really great gunner, played his, what, 7-8 years, got his pension, did everything the right way. And then now he owns a waste management business in Houston that's making a killing, making a lot of money. So he's been one that's been really fun to follow. I'll tell you another guy who, and I think he, this is something I don't think a lot of LSU fans have kind of thought about since the days of Colin Kaepernick or kind of when he was standing for what he felt was a lot of social injustice in the league and taking a knee. Eric Reed was right there by his side through a lot of it as 49ers teammates. And I can remember Eric was probably one of the smartest recruits I ever covered. Like in high school, he was a 4.0 student at Dutchtown. But I could remember, and he was a big time player. Like when they signed him, it was a big deal. And I remember covering his recruiting, and I would call him often for updates or whatever it might be. And more than half the time he would answer and be like, I'm at work, and he worked at Walmart. And he said, I have to call you later. But he comes from, you know, I'd say a pretty, you know, middle-class, above middle-class family where his dad ran transportation and parking at LSU forever. His mom's successful. His brother went to where? Stanford. His other brothers, one played college soccer up in the Northeast. So, but he worked at Walmart. And I would always ask, I think I asked him one time, I said, you know, why are you working at Walmart? What, you know, you have to have a job right now. Your parents kind of want you to do multiple things. And he said, yeah, my parents said I needed to go get a job at Walmart because I need to see how, you know, everybody lives and how people, you know, not in high school are making money. And if, you know, if you don't go to college or, you know, what's your path, your future. And he just, even long before the Kaepernick days, he was thinking on a level of that I just thought was different than any other high school kid I saw. And God, he was a great college player too. Just a big kid who, was a leader in the locker room and obviously went on to get drafted and play really well in San Francisco and bounced around since then. But I always just thought for a guy that doesn't get talked about a ton now, he was always one of my favorite guys to cover. I just thought that I felt like he was 45 years old when he was in high school. He was just on another level than everybody else. And And I was just intrigued by that.
You've covered recruiting for a long time now. What would you say are some of the keys to becoming a great recruiter? Is there any particular words that constantly come up when you're speaking to players that maybe would sort of summarize that?
I would say the number one thing is, you know, when you're dealing with talking to kids about their future, a college commitment, you know, a pretty big decision in their lives is, you know, not spoiling any level of trust with them. I think we've seen people who follow recruiting could name recruiting reporters out there who've done the job and aren't in it anymore or weren't popular. And it was because by and large, they would, you know, burn kids or make things up that weren't true. And I think that it seems easily avoidable, but a lot of people fall into that trap. So I think building trust with everybody. And I think for me, it's just been staying steady and giving kind of my time to everyone. I talk to a lot of kids behind the scenes who go to Nichols or Southeastern or Tulane or, you know, wherever. It doesn't matter to me. Yeah. But help them get video out there or, you know, update their profile or whatever it might be, just because I think that's just a cool dynamic to the job. I'll share one story, and this kind of is talking to my approach of now learning that I kind of give my time, and I would suggest anyone who wants to follow recruiting, don't be like I was in the beginning where I said, no, I don't want to cover swimming and diving and all that, so I'm just going to walk away from it instead of embracing it. I can remember being at a camp many moons ago, and a high school coach, which I hear this all the time, you know, a high school coach comes up and says, you got to interview my kid and build him a profile. He's going to be a beast. And, you know, he's the best. And I've heard that time and time again, but, a coach brings up a little small kid and says, hey, did you see him out there today at the 7-on-7? And I said, man, you know, I was watching hundreds of kids. I guess I didn't notice. And he said, well, he shut everyone down, all the best players, Jarvis Landry, everyone. He shut them down. Odell, nobody stood a chance. And I was like, all right, you know, wow. And he's like, yeah, interview him. He doesn't have any offers yet, but he'll be the best player you ever interview. And I interviewed him, and then I just never wrote the story. And one day I was going back, and I found, cutting through some audio, and I found that interview, and it was Tyrann Mathieu. So I was the one who messed that one up and didn't get his first interview out there. So. I think I've learned since then to I kind of give the time of day to everybody. And I just, like I said, I think my biggest enjoyment out of this is the sort of social interaction of it and being able to kind of watch other people grow up and reach their goals. And for so many kids coming to LSU and into college right now, they might be, you know, first generation college graduates. And that's such a big deal to so many families. And it's cool to kind of see them reach those goals and then maybe reach a professional career or whatever it might be. So my biggest advice to people is honesty and have a real sense of work ethic, but to also just kind of dive deep into everything. Don't be too big for any, you know, player or team or whatever it might be, just because there's so much experience that can be gained from it. And everybody sort of somewhere, right? Not everybody is starting out at the top, and I've learned that so many coaches now, there's head coaches around the country of college football teams that I knew 15 years ago when they were GAs or student workers, and, you know, in the grand scheme of a coaching staff, they were a nobody on the staff, but I knew them and we talked and, you know, whatever it might be, and 15 years later they're a head coach somewhere, they're an offensive coordinator, and now all of a sudden they're in a position where, you know, you do need them for interviews or whatever it might be, or information. So building relationships, I think, is key in any industry, right? And no matter what you're doing, relationship building is key. And I think that holds true for recruiting in a pretty big way.
Yeah. And sort of during your time covering recruiting, what are some of the craziest recruiting stories you've heard? And you're more than welcome to not mention names if you'd rather do that.
Yeah, you always hear stuff like before NIL, of paying players, or the night before signing day, dropping off a bag of money at someone's house or a car or whatever, like that kind of stuff you'd always hear. And you don't know if it's true or not, and you just suspect that, yeah, probably it has some elements of truth to it. In terms of, I'd say for me, still one of the wildest, oddest recruitments would have been Landon Collins, who went to Alabama from Louisiana and ultimately had a great NFL career. He's a really good player. And his brother, Gerald Willis, but I guess more specifically their mother, April Justin, twice went on national television, ESPN. And when her son made the announcement, like very much was upset about it. And I remember covering Landon's recruitment and saying, man, Bama feels good about it, but his mom's telling me that, you know, he's going to go to LSU and that's just going to be the end of the discussion. When he announced for Bama, she gets on ESPN and says, I don't agree with it. He should have gone to LSU. He's making the wrong decision. And then when her next son, Gerald, comes up and everyone's like, no way, this is going to happen again. He's going to go to LSU. And he goes and he went to Florida and Miami. I can't, maybe he committed to Florida at the time. But once again, his mom on national television said, I've said it before, I say it again, he's making a mistake. Should have gone to LSU. I'm rolling with LSU. I had never seen a parent get involved to that degree, and certainly not on national television, and then not twice. So I'd say that was one of, I think that still takes the cake for me for the most interesting recruitment I'd seen. And I think recently, and now we'll, he's at Georgia now, but Eric Gilbert, who was a five-star tight end and came to LSU and played briefly, obviously, during the pandemic year in 2020, and then sat out all of last season in 21, and is now at Georgia. So he's already had quite a career path for a kid who was in high school not long ago and hadn't played a ton of football yet. But he was the highest-rated tight end ever, like in the modern era. So let's say the 2000s on. No tight end had ever been ranked higher than he was. So this was like five-star, rare air. He's from Georgia. And it was pretty clear to everyone that he was going to Georgia or Alabama. And he goes up to make his announcement. And I've got it. I'm watching it, doing something else. But I'm watching it. I remember like on my phone or maybe my computer was open. And since it was just this big news, like it was just like finding out like where – a five-star top 10 player was going that was maybe going to go to an SEC school, like a, you know, Arch Manning. That's not that big of Arch Manning, but someone like that. And I was just more curious where he was going, and I'm doing whatever I was doing. And he goes, LSU. And I thought he was doing one of the, you know, like
the fake reveal.
So the whole audience there, he's like in an auditorium with a school, is like laughing and they're like, next. And he just sits there and he just keeps sitting there. And then he was like, oh no, really, LSU. And like the whole place is quiet and then kind of claps. And I'm like, well, I didn't pre-write a story. We didn't do a graphic. I didn't even follow this, because even talking to LSU sources, none of them expected to get him. So it wasn't, we never heard LSU from anyone. No one at Bama thought it was LSU. No one at Georgia thought it was LSU. And he picks LSU. And then we come to find out the LSU recruiting workers, so like student workers, everyone's out at practice and they're doing the same thing I'm doing. They're just watching it to see if he's picking Alabama or Georgia, and he picks LSU, and they run out to practice to tell him. And Coach O tells the story, or has told the story before, that he thought the building was on fire because all the recruiting kids are running out screaming. And they're like, Eric Gilbert just committed to LSU. And Coach O stops practice and calls him, and the kid's like, yeah, I'm in. And ultimately, he does stick and sign. And I had never, no five-star of that status, I don't think, whether it was LSU or elsewhere, had ever pulled a shocker quite like that. And then we had the kid recently who committed at Jackson State on signing day. And that was sort of that same sort of, wow, what like a shocking moment. But I just remember the Gilbert thing was just, a five-star doesn't just sneak up and shock even a coaching, every coaching staff in the modern era, but somehow Gilbert pulled it off. I had not seen anything like that before.
So pretty much all the top quarterbacks for the class of 2023 have committed to a program. Notably, LSU is currently without one of those. Do you think LSU will be able to flip Ricky Collins from Purdue when it's all said and done, particularly as well when other schools are already trying to lock down quarterbacks for the 2024 class?
Right. I think Ricky Collins is a kid who goes to, you know, his high school is less than 15-minute drive over to LSU. So proximity, when, you know, they're recruiting quarter, Dante Moore is from Michigan, Jaden Rashada is from California. You know, there were a couple of kids, Arch Manning and Eli Holstein, here in Louisiana that people just knew they weren't ever going to go to LSU for different reasons. And yeah. Holstein went to Bama, Arch Manning goes to Texas, and the new coaching staff seemed to circle Jaden Rashada out in California and Dante Moore up in Michigan as two guys they really liked. And there were others, Jackson Arnold, who was committed to Oklahoma, Bazina, Christopher Bazina's committed to Clemson. But quarterback dominoes, like in recruiting with quarterbacks, you're usually only taking one. And once the dominoes start dropping, all the kids want to get their spot. It's like musical chairs, right? Where, you know, if you're going to keep having a scholarship pulled off the table because they've taken a quarterback, you're eventually want to kind of sit down when the music stops before it stops. And I think that while as an LSU fan, it's very fair and fine to say, man, I wish we could have gotten Eli Holstein or Arch Manning, you know, a local guy early on that we were after. I wish we could have gotten Dante Moore, who's some, you know, a top three or four quarterback nationally. But ultimately, Ricky Collins is the number 12 quarterback in the country. Louisiana doesn't produce quarterbacks that often. Like, it's rare that they would have a top 15 quarterback in Louisiana, let alone three of them. So you want to come away with one of those guys. I think that from the start, Ricky was the one that seemed to make the most sense that they'd have the best shot at. And this new LSU staff has recruited Ricky hard. You know, I don't think that, or I know, and I don't think LSU fans presume that they were just recruiting the other guys. And now they got to go, you know, say, hey, Ricky, we're the new coaches here and we want to flip you. They've had him on campus. They've been working him nonstop just as hard as they've had these other guys. So I think that the odds on favorite by far would be for Ricky Collins to join the class, because like you said, you're already starting to recruit 2024 kids for next year. And I think the good thing right now for LSU is that the quarterback room is four deep and it's spaced out a bit, right? Like you've got a veteran in Miles Brennan. You've got Jaden Daniels, who will be a senior, but has already graduated college. He's played three seasons of football. So two older guys, and then Nussmeier has been a year in college, but hasn't, you know, hadn't been a starter or anything yet. Still took a red shirt. And then you've got Walker Howard as a new kid. That's a good, you're not in a position where you feel like, man, we need to recruit someone that's going to start. And I think if you did, you would be in the transfer portal trying to figure that out. And I think they feel good about, let's say they can get a Ricky Collins, and then the next year you recruit another high school quarterback in the 24 class. And you try to put yourself in a spot where, and this is what teams are going to have to do now, is try to strike that balance between we recruit kids and develop them and they stay and they ultimately play and we're a deep squad, and then having to take transfers to kind of patch up trouble spots or wherever you might be weak. And, you know, Brian Kelly has said before, no other team in the country this year, Alex, did, I think, let's say on average, every team signed 30 kids. Let's just say that's what it is. LSU was a 50-50 split on taking high school kids and transfers, college kids. So that had never been seen before. You know, we hadn't had this adjustment in scholarship numbers and the transfer portal where it is now, to where you would take double digit guys. And as Kelly said, that's no way, it's not a sustainable model. I can't go recruit half a class of transfers because they're all going to be in their last year and they're, you know, only have a year or two of eligibility maybe left. And now I've got huge gaps in my program, and I'm always trying to fix it with transfers. So I think quarterback specifically, they're in a spot right now where you can kind of start to develop guys, start to bring in one a class. But again, I'll be the first to say, and that it won't be a shock if Joe Burrow or whomever, you know, if some big quarterback goes in the transfer portal in the future, LSU's going to entertain it, because if it makes your team better, I think at the end of the day, especially quarterback, that's one position where you kind of can break from the norm and say, all right, we've got to do it. Let's take a transfer.
Sure. Yeah. And sort of moving forward and into the future, do you think under Brian Kelly and the staff that he's put together, that LSU will have more of a national presence in regard to recruiting areas that LSU previously didn't typically recruit. I mean, you look at the 2023 class already, there's guys there from Minnesota, Maryland, and Indiana.
Yeah, I think it's I think it's one of the more unique elements to watch moving forward, because I think it can be a slippery slope. And I say that LSU is a national brand very much, and Brian Kelly and a lot of the staff are coming from the Midwest or the Northeast or careers there. And then that you do have relationships with guys in or high schools or whatever it might be, or you're familiar with Indiana and the East Coast and Minnesota, New Jersey, and they've got a California commitment. These aren't areas typically that LSU's ever recruited. LSU's typically always recruited the Southeast and primarily Louisiana. And I wonder right now, just with the new staff, is, hey, look, they're coming in, they're trying to evaluate everyone. And Brian Kelly probably is familiar with a lot of the commitments they have right now from the Northeast, from his time at Notre Dame, and Brian Poling is a recruiting coordinator. So it's kind of maybe an easier way for them to say, look, let's grab these guys. And look, a lot of the guys we're talking about, depending on the ranking service you're using, are top 100 players, top 50 players in a couple of cases, you know, top 250. So they're not going across the country to pick up scrubs. I mean, these are talented kids, obviously, but I say it's a slippery slope twofold. One, I think in the current modern era of the transfer portal and all that, that kids are have a ticket. If I want to transfer, I used to have to sit out a whole year and then I couldn't transfer to another program within my conference, or there would be a lot of red tape to it, or I'd have to get permission from the school for these certain schools to be, you know, they could block schools that I couldn't go to. Now, if I want to transfer, I just have to tell my compliance department I'm transferring. They put my name in the portal. I can go anywhere where I want. And I'll start next year. Eli Ricks, LSU to Alabama. Yep. We saw a lot of kids go from, you know, one big school to another that play each other, that have to compete in the same division of a conference. So because of that, I think kids are going to be quicker to pull the trigger on, if I'm not playing or I'm not happy or and here's why I say this, I'm a little homesick, they could leave. We saw Corey Kiner this past year. He played as a true freshman. I mean, he was going to come back and play again as a true sophomore at running back. And I think there is an element of being homesick to him. The coaching staff changes. He goes back home to Ohio, specifically to Cincinnati, where he's from. And it's understandable. It's like not hard to say, okay, that kid came down here from the Midwest, stayed a year, got to play. But if he's going back home to play at Cincinnati, there's an element of wanting to be back home. And I think because of that, and we just saw if you get into roster trouble and you're playing with 40 something guys in a bowl game, it's not good, you know, and you're all of a sudden even in the Fiesta Bowl a couple of years ago, Joe Burrow's first year, I think people forget they put together a defensive backfield that game of like Jontre Kirkland and those guys were like having to play receiver and go to corner and play. And it was just a complete makeshift operation. And I think now with the transfer portal, guys will leave even more quickly. And I guess I'm a long-winded way of saying that I would recruit kids, and if I'm these schools, especially if I'm a Louisiana, you know, an LSU in Louisiana or, you know, Georgia or wherever, Bama, that are closer to home, because if they're not playing right away, if they're a little homesick, their parents are still at every game, or their family comes down and sees them, or they can go again. And we see it all the time with LSU. I mean, guys right now on the team, Todd Harris, Miles Brennan, they're in their sixth seasons. They've stuck around because they're from here. They don't want to go anywhere else. They want to be at LSU. And I think there's an element of that that you need to appreciate and embrace moving forward in recruiting, and I'm certain they will, of understanding that, hey, if we can load up on these kids, we saw them do it in the transfer portal. Joe Fuscia, Greg Brooks, they took a lot of kids who were from Louisiana, and those kids said, I wanted to be at LSU coming out of high school. I didn't have the offer. I went and played somewhere else and I loved it. And, you know, I got a degree at that school and it was great, but I want to be here. I want my family to come every weekend. I want it to be part of this kind of culture and community. So I think the first reason I would say that I'd like them to be a bit more heavy on Louisiana and the area would be that. I think long-term it's good for roster development or continuity, however you want to put it. The other would be, and here would be my easiest way to say it. Everyone says Brian Kelly is going to work out at LSU because of what? Well, because A, he's right with Nick Saban as the winningest head coach across the past 20, 30 years. You know, in his case, 30 years of being a head coach at multiple levels, he's got a proven track record of knowing how to build a program and knowing how to win. And he's done it at Notre Dame, which isn't the easiest place to do it. You know, not being in a conference and having certainly higher academic standards and hurdles to get over than a lot of other teams that are competing on that national stage. But if you combine a coach like that with that pet, with that track record, with a program that's done something that nobody else has done, which is won three national championships in 20 years with three different head coaches. And obviously that span was a little bit shorter, but doing so with Miles or Saban first in 03, Miles in 07, you get back to a national championship in 2011, and then O wins one for you in 2019. Three different coaches all won here, and people say, well, if all they could do it, certainly Brian Kelly has got this track record of being a really successful coach. You put him with LSU, match made in heaven. I would agree. The caveat to that would be all three of those coaches, 80% of their recruiting classes were guys from Louisiana. And you can think of every team, 03, 7, 11, 2019, so many very big pieces to it were kids from Louisiana, certainly the receivers, the running backs, a lot of the defensive line, whatever it might be, were guys that were here and that you recruited out of the state. And per capita, it's one of the richest talent kind of pools in the country for both college athletes and NFL athletes. So I don't think we'll see them forever have like a bunch of Minnesota kids on roster and not any Louisiana kids. I think that'll even itself out and then it'll go back towards heavy on Louisiana. But I think you're coming off a year where we saw last year, it's understandable. You were 500 back-to-back seasons. You just were firing your head coach and you're changing your whole staff. But the reality was, a bunch of kids went to Bama, some kids went to A&M, you know, wherever it might be, left the state. And if you're looking right now, if you're just an average fan and you pull up, let me look at Louisiana's top 10 in the rankings. You don't see a lot of LSU in there. It's Texas, it's Bama, it's, you know, whomever, A&M trending for a kid or whatever it might be. So I understand fans saying, okay, should I be worried about this? Not worried. I just think it's an interesting thing to monitor. I'm far from pressing the panic button, considered signing day is a long time away. And this coaching staff is literally just like 4, 5, 6 months into kind of feeling out how they want to do this and building the foundation. And they've gone on a nice little run recently with commits. So far from pressing the panic button, but I do think that, and I apologize for the very long-winded response here, but I think that's one of the most interesting dynamics to watch right now is between the transfer portal and just the reality that Louisiana produces so many great athletes is how much does this staff prioritize Louisiana in the future and how good will those evals be to keep these guys at home that that maybe, you know, at other times could slip outside the state?
Sure. No, thank you for that answer. Just two very quick questions. So your last day at 247Sports was back in May. What does the future hold?
So I'll be back by the football season, back in the realm of covering LSU and sort of everything that I've been doing. Really the only reason I haven't been able to say anything publicly yet is just because of red tape contract, all that stuff, which is fine. I understand, but it's given me a chance to actually reset and think about how much the business has changed and how I want to do my job moving forward. And I think that's been good for me, kind of really looking around and saying, what have I done right and wrong? And what are other people doing and where are we going? Which is what we talked about earlier. So, but yeah, by football season, I'll be a full go again, but until then I'll be hanging out with you and doing a little radio spots here and there. And trust me, my honey-do list is very long, so I'm going to need football season to stay in the distance for a while. I've got a lot to get through here to stay out of trouble on the home front.
and sort of last question, give me one word to describe the future of college football recruiting.
Oh, man. I don't think people will agree. I would say exciting. I think that for a long time, it was what it was. It was the same thing. There would be, you covered a kid, he went through his recruitment, he got recruited, he took his visits, and he went, you know, ultimately committed, and you never knew if money was involved or what really was the biggest factors beyond what someone would say publicly or maybe what people would be speculating about on the internet. Now with NIL and with social media and kind of the continued dominance, you know, kind of in the spotlight of what the rankings mean. I mean, college coaches will say all the time, I don't pay attention to recruiting rankings. I've never cared about them. And they're lying. And they'll be the first also then on signing day brag that they had a top five recruiting class or whatever it might be. So that they're very, they pay attention to it then, but they don't pay attention to it anytime else is what we're led to believe. But I just think with kind of just the landscape changing in college athletics so much, the transfer portal, all of that, like I think recruiting now is never going to stop. Like you're recruiting guys to stay on your team. You're recruiting guys from other teams to come join your team. You're recruiting high school guys. You're recruiting JUCO guys. I just think there's been so many different new layers added to it that for me, I think it's exciting. And I, like I said, I've spent a good amount of the summer so far and will continue kind of thinking about that and thinking about how it should be covered moving forward and what people want to consume or know moving forward and kind of out of that time period of what recruiting used to be.
Yeah. Well, Shea, is there anything else you'd like to add before we wrap this up?
Oh man, I think I've talked nonstop. I don't want to be your longest one yet. I watched a bunch of the other interviews. I've enjoyed them. So I was glad to be a part of it. I've enjoyed kind of the laid back setting here. It reminds me of when you and Jordy Claude were on together. It was like a clash of laid back atmospheres. That was enjoyable.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It's been a pleasure to talk to you, and thank you so much for your time. And yeah, best of luck with everything in the future.
Thanks so much for having me, Alex. I appreciate it.